agents or the FBI or something, and the report comes redacted. Look at that. I don't know if that means I really shouldn't have asked what happened before he got here, but I'm not going to. I had prepared a whole bunch of statistics and interesting little trivia and dates and towns and something you'd all forget within 24 hours anyway. So let me get to the part that's important, and that's 2006, when this lovely woman became the pastor of our church. In my long life, I've been a member of two churches, one in Pottsville and this one. During that time, incredibly, I've only been involved with four pastors. But I can tell you honestly, no one like this. No one like this. Her knowledge of scripture, her love of history, and the combination of the two made Sunday sermons so interesting, informative, challenging, inspirational. I can't tell you how many times in my drive home of 5 or 6 miles, whatever it is, I sat all the time with her words ringing in my ears. Something I didn't know, some challenge that she threw my way. And I can tell you this honestly, I thought, if somehow I could convince Pastor Sonny to come home with me, and every morning,
got it,
give me a mini 5-minute sermon, I might have a chance of being a decent person. That never happened, of course. I just want to say one thing. From the very beginning, and by the way, I became a member of this church, this congregation, shortly after she became pastor. I couldn't believe how many times she stood up in front of everyone and started talking about this church family. Church family. Everything was church family. Church family. What is this church family business? Here it is. Here it is. And I just want to say, that doesn't just happen. That takes a lot of dedication and leadership and nurturing through the years. And it has become, for me, the happiest, calmest place that I can be anywhere in this earth, among these people in this building. And I mean that sincerely.
Amen.
Amen. Her sermons were just absolutely incredible. She delivered them with her lips, but you know they came from her heart. Pastor John, you've got big shoes to fill. But we all have confidence that you will do it. And you will do it very well. And this church family will continue for many, many, many years into the future. It will get bigger and stronger all the time. And for many of you in the youth group and you young kids that are here, it's going to be your responsibility. And someday, and I hope honestly, many, many, many years from now, Pastor John will announce that he's retiring. And I'm sure that those of you that are here will plan for him a retirement supper, lunch, or whatever. And somebody, like happened to me, will be asked, would you like to say a few words? Well, if it's you that they ask, by all means accept. And you'll have a chance to tell Pastor John what I have a chance to tell Pastor Sonny today. From the bottom of my heart, on behalf of everybody in your church family, thank you. Amen.
Ha, ha, ha.
Here I am.
You've got to help me through the sign.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's nice to see everyone. And I asked Jane if I could just say a few words about how Sonny has impacted my life. To start with, 2006, I think it was, when Sonny first met me and I met her. We were looking for a pastor, as you were down here, and we had three candidates, of which Sonny was one. At first, when I, well, the deal was you would hear all of them and they would come to the church, take the service and give a trial sermon, then we would vote for them afterwards. With me, when it came to Sonny, I had some doubt. I thought, she's a fake. I couldn't believe that someone so nice and wonderful could be so true. It was only after she got the pastorship that I realized, with Sonny, what you see is what you get. She was real. Soon on, in summer of that year, I came to her and I told her that I had, through the years, past several years, I had taken the church group from both churches. We would go to a Reading Phillies game, Faith Night at the Phillies. And doing such with about 25 or more members, you had the opportunity to have one of your group throw out the first pitch for the game. Well, I said to Sonny, it's your time. First she said no. She says, I can't throw.
I throw like a girl.
Then I asked her, I said, tell John to teach you. And you know what she said? She said, he throws like a girl, too. Well, after a little work, though, with John working with her, she agreed to do it. And guess what? She threw a perfect strike that night. That was when I got to realize that we'd not only got a true minister, but we also got a forever friend. Because after that, she and John invited us to their beautiful home over near Lake Winona, and we had barbecue and a lunch on her deck. After that, Pat and I invited them to our home in December, and we had Christmas dinner. And then we also had them on to the shore for a few days on the Jersey Beach. We stayed at my daughter's condo in Wildwood. But then tragedy struck. Between 2008 and 2013, Sonny was with me when we were to Lehigh Valley Hospital in Allentown. And the doctor diagnosed Pat with Alzheimer's. I learned then that the lifespan for someone with the disease was about 8 years. Well, the first 3 years, I cared for her at home. But eventually, it gets too much, and I admitted her to Seton Manor, where I would visit her every day. Early on in the disease, I got very angry. I felt there was something wrong, and I fell away from the one thing that could help me through it. I lost my religion. For a few weeks, I didn't go to church, and Sonny came back to the house to see what was wrong. And I told her I couldn't believe that a loving father could do this to his child. She told me that wasn't his will. She said, I'm having office hours at the church. Come up every week and we'll talk about it and pray on it. So I would go up, and the days that I wasn't there, she would come back to the house, and we would pray. Eventually, she brought me back. And thank God she did, because a life without religion is empty. October, Sunday, October 27, 2013, Pat died. I won't say that it was easy or hard to lose the love of your life of 54 years, but with Sonny's help, it was much better than I thought it would be. The times when I would come to her and thank her for what she did, she would never take credit. Her humble way, she would say, it's a God thing. And yes, it was a God thing, but with an awful lot of help from this wonderful woman. Thank you, Sonny.
For those of you who were here on December 26th when Sonny gave her final sermon, she shared a little bit about me and what she saw in that first confirmation class she had here at Christ Church. So I'll return the favor. And it's just as good as what she saw in me, even though I'm still not sure where she saw it. The confirmation, the pastor and the interim pastors that we had before Sonny came, confirmation class was just a burden. It was no fun. It was just, we were just there to learn. But when Sonny came, she has these bunch of 12, 13-year-olds, and there was more joy than I had ever seen in a pastor before. There was more energy. There was more love for the scripture, for sharing the word of God, for teaching and preaching these to these young children what it meant to be a Christian, and that really stuck with me. And it made a big difference than it I probably would have had we had those same kind of pastors who just rambled on and were boring. And I hope I am sharing as much of that joy in my confirmation class right now. I don't see any of them here to verify whether or not that's true. Jake, am I boring?
No.
All right. A plus. So that was what I first saw of Sonny, and it has carried through and shown, I'm sure, to each and every one of you through the years that she's been our pastor. And so when I got out of college then, so many years later, Sonny has been and will continue to be one of the biggest influences in my life and as I continue to work as a pastor and a minister of the gospel. Rick, you shared, I got big shoes to fill. But thank goodness Sonny has shown me so much about how to wear those shoes. There is not going to be almost any part of my ministry that she has not had an influence in. So whenever I succeed, we can look to Sonny. Whenever I fail, we can look to me. Because that is how much Sonny has changed and improved me as a minister, changed my life and my love for the Lord. From that first confirmation class that we had with her way back in 2006. And so that has carried with me, and it will continue to carry with me as long as I'm a minister here, and for all of you. It will continue to influence you, all that she has done for each and every one of us through all these years. And as long as we are here, Sonny's influence will be on this church in some way, whether she is in the pew or serving somewhere else, wherever she is. We still have her influence on this church, and it has grown and done so much for each and every one of us. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
John, I thought you were going to say that when you fail, you can look at Mark. Did you hear that?
No.
I said, I thought that when you said, when you fail, you can. I thought you were going to say you can look at Mark. All right. Well, about 15 years ago in the fall of 2006, our youth group here at Christ Church was only about, I don't know, 6 to 7 months old. We're doing pretty well as a youth group, and we had a strong backing from our consistory and the church at large. But when I heard that one of the pastors we were looking at as candidates to fill the pulpit had been a youth pastor for many years and was a strong champion of youth ministry, I just knew that we needed that pastor here at Christ Church. As some will no doubt attest, it was a rocky start with this new pastor. First, she didn't get enough votes by the congregation to be approved.
I am a woman.
And so my dreams of having a senior pastor who understood youth ministry were seemingly dashed. And yeah, I wasn't happy about that. And I think I had some strong words at the next consistory or maybe it was a pulpit committee meeting.
Not you.
No, not me. Some words that I almost regretted, but although, you know, I don't think I did, because I think there were enough people in that room that had the same thoughts, and we agreed to give it another go, right? And I'm so happy that we did that. Pastor Sunny won the hearts of the congregation, and at the next congregational vote, she became our full-time pastor. And I was right. I couldn't have asked for a better senior pastor. She has not only been a champion of the youth ministry here at Christ Church, she has been a protector, a defender, a nurturer, and sometimes a blocker. Many of you, have no idea what it's like to be an adult leader in a youth ministry. It's often been compared to herding cats. Wet cats. Irritated wet cats through the snow while trying to tell them about Jesus. There have been broken windows, broken pews, broken doors, broken windows, broken railings. Did I mention the broken windows?
And storm windows.
Sometimes the first thing anyone thinks of when something's broken around is here is, and you know, sometimes I think this too, is what did the youth group do now? And sometimes it is a youth group, but sometimes it's not. But one thing that Pastor Sonny always understood is the cost of youth ministry is far outweighed by the fruits of youth ministry. When you see the young people who come to know and love Jesus, and when they then in turn serve the church in their many often unseen and humble ways. We have a lot of youth who do a lot of stuff behind the scenes here at the church on a Sunday morning, and there's youth student leaders. We have one youth who became a student leader, then an adult leader, and now is the pastor of our church. In 2006, we were thinking about going on our first mission trip the following summer to Copper Hill, Tennessee. And I was not very sure about this whole thing. I mean, it was expensive. Where would we get the money for this? Who would go along as adult leaders? You know, I wasn't really a youth pastor back then. I was a glorified events coordinator for the youth group. I talked to this brand new pastor of Christ Church in Keensburg and told her about my many, many misgivings. And I'll never forget how she told me that there are just some things that you just need to start working on in faith, and that God will help you to work it out. Have faith and start moving. And so I did. And you know what? She was right. Somehow we got the money for the trip. And two adults from Zion stepped up to go on that trip, Dawn Passon and her father, Scott Leiby. Dawn then went on to become a legendary adult leader in the youth group for many years. Pastor Sonny has always encouraged the youth ministry and his participation in the life of the church over the years. She gave up many, many Sundays so the youth could run the show for Youth Sundays. And she's encouraged the youth praise band J2O to be a regular part of the Sunday services and lately perform for the church picnics. Really, there's just too much to go through. We'd be here all day. But a youth ministry certainly never had a better senior pastor than Pastor Sonny. As much as she was a great pastor for the youth ministry, she was also an amazing friend to me personally, a friend and a mentor. We've done a lot of ministry together in the last 15 years. And when you do that much ministry together, you either become enemies or you become friends. And friends we are indeed. She assisted me in my very first wedding, doing the official bit at the end because I wasn't yet ordained. And at least I ran the video live stream for one or two of her weddings, right? But what we did a lot together, other than Sunday services, was funerals. More than most people would want to, maybe, but there's a certain humble honor in doing a funeral service. You get to bring God into the presence of those who are mourning. And I've never been in one with Pastor Sunny, whether I gave the meditation or whether she gave it, where we didn't tell the people gathered there about the good news of Jesus Christ. We always knew that about each other, too, without even coming out and really saying it, that Jesus is the reason, just Jesus. Jesus is the reason for everything. There's so much that has gone into our friendship in the last 15 years, so much. In the last few years with the COVID situation, I've been working in the church every day, and we spent even more time together, sometimes working on stuff, but more often than not, just shooting the breeze for a while before going back to work. It's been quieter without you in the office, Pastor Sonny. Pastor John isn't as talkative as you are. But we'll get him there. Joe and I are working on him. But we're going to miss you, Pastor Sonny. Thank you for 15 incredible years of ministry and friendship. I think we need a few minutes and we're going to have something special.
Alan is.
Oh, Alan's.
Well,
I thought
I'm
that
sorry.
Was afterwards.
That's after. Never mind. You're right.
All right. We have the crisscrosses come up here. I have to reconnect this.
Why did you have to say that? Because we talked about
hey, that was a late addition.
It was just a joke.
We were practicing something together. And we came up with a name for our new group.
No.
Crisscross is okay, right?
Ready? Three.
Crisscross. All right, I need my mic. All right.
I was just added this morning.
We need to ask Pastor Sonny to come up right over here.
Hold on, dance.
Go
get the
picture. Oh, he forgot his picture. Come and stand right here.
Stand?
Yeah. We're going to need a few minutes. We forgot the pick. Oh, it's down here. I thought it was upstairs yet. Yes.
Absolutely.
Very afraid.
Yeah. Petrified.
I'll stand in front of this vodka box.
God knows she's
going to
do this.
I think
can
I take my shoes off?
Sure.
Really?
Yes. You'll be a star?
No, it's not showing.
Are you going to shock me?
Hold on.
Not yet.
A few minutes.
We're having some technical difficulties. Okay. Bear with us.
Oh, she got the glove.
Good job, guy.
Well, maybe I'll be Minnie Pearl.
Where's Denise?
Oh. Where is she? Oh, we have the people here know who Minnie Pearl
is. I think they're going to have
it on. Oh, there's Denise.
Not
there.
Will we have the members of the choir come up front?
Where's Denise? Denise, do you have the music?
We have it.
She might have it on.
Wow. Where's the music?
That's what we're in choir.
Where's the music?
I got a cat with her now. Can you see anything?
No.
The mic's turned off. I gotta get on the other side with the man.
Hey, where's my
This is one of Pastor Sonny's favorite hymns, so that's why we're today.
My great-grandfather, who was a United Methodist pastor in Philadelphia, this was his favorite hymn, which I didn't know. I never knew him, but I told my grandmother one time that this was my favorite hymn, and she said, oh my goodness, that was my father's favorite.
Oh,
This one's still working? Yes.
Well, you know, Pastor Sonny, you always kept it exciting at church. Some of the things I know I missed, one of the things was Janis Joplin. She sang that song. And, you know, for some reason, I was not here, and I never heard that. I heard, like, bits and pieces of a bit. I never heard her sing the whole song. And I won't ask you to do that.
It's a mercy of God, Alan.
Yeah. Another thing is, you know, especially if you sat in the front, you never knew what was happening. All of a sudden, an egg could come flying out of it.
You were sleeping.
And I don't remember exactly what that was, but why those eggs came out.
Some of them were hard-boiled.
Yeah, some. So, you know, you really, you said the church family, Rick said that, and we really are a true family and bonded together because of you and your love for us. So on behalf of the church here, I want to present this plaque to you. I'll read it.
Aww.
It says, Pastor Sonny Stock, blessings on your retirement. 27 years of service, thousands of Sunday sermons, numerous seeds planted, many prayers lifted up, caring, encouraging, well done, good and faithful servant.
Oh my
Thank
God.
You very much. Yes, you have been a pastor and a friend. And you too, John.
Next. That's
her
afternoon.
Do
so
you want to say anything?
Yeah.
The last word.
Yeah.
Yeah, I need the last word.
We might be getting a sermon now. Yeah.
I'm not telling any stories much. But I have to tell you, as I started to get older, Mary and Richard were leaving church one day, and I said to Mary, you know, Mary, I don't mind growing older. I said, but you know, my memory seems to be failing me. And Mary leaned in and she said to me, I have some bad news. It gets worse. And I think your focus, my focus anyway, I can't speak for you, does change as you get older. And the med class always accused me of constantly talking about my death. Now, I don't think that's true, except that that's also what the exchange students always accuse me of. And I think it's also what my daughter-in-law accuses me of as well, and my son. And Pastor Joan is here today, and I always pestered her for this prayer. And because your focus does change as you go over, but as I thought about this, I think it's important for all of us. And that in the 5th century, as you know how I love history.
And you remember it well.
And I remember it well. John was a teenager then. There was an Archbishop of Constantinople. And his name was John Chrysostom. And he wrote a divine liturgy that is still in use by the Byzantine church today. And you know, the only thing that I love more than history is church history, which is why I'm burdening you with this today. But he wrote part of the liturgy, and this always impressed me, and I begged and begged Joan for years, because she was raised in that worship tradition before she became an evangelical pastor. And finally, about a month ago, she sent me this prayer. So I don't know what encouraged her to do that. But the prayer goes like this, and it says, this is a prayer that in the Byzantine tradition, much as in the Latin Rite tradition, the congregation will entreat the Lord, and then the congregation will respond, hear our prayer or something like that. And this is the prayer, and it says, for a Christian, painless, blameless, and peaceful end to my life, and a good account on the awesome day of the tribunal of Jesus Christ. And the response is, we ask the Lord, or whatever you're, depending on what church you're in. And that prayer has always struck me as just a prayer that no matter what stage in life, we should always pray, because every day closer to Jesus, and you don't like to hear that, but you don't want to lose your focus. You don't want to get caught up in things of this world that we are so prone to being caught up in, and lose sight of the fact that we are all just passing through. And you know how difficult it is for me to leave as captain of this ship, because now I'm just a member of the crew. But being a member of the crew is incredibly important. And we're on this journey, and we're all going home. And some of us are going to get there before others, but we're all heading to the same place. And for those of us who have Christ firmly, firmly in our hearts, and who have stepped over that line and thrown in with the Lord, even though we may go on different paths, we're still heading to the same place. And this is just a season. No matter where we are in life, on this earth, this is just a season. And we're all just passing through. So I would encourage us all to remember that. And to remember that for those of us who are washed in the blood of the Lamb, that, we're heading home. And so... Even if I, who knows? Who knows what tomorrow will bring, right? But, that the old cliche, but we know who's there. We know who holds tomorrow. So I am mindful of Helen Dunn. The story of when I left Helen Dunn one day. And I said, Helen, I love you, Helen. And she said, I can tell. I hope all of you can tell that I have loved you and I still love you. And no matter what, we're all in this together. And as the world circles the drain more and more and more, we're going to need each other more and more and more.
Amen.
Until we see the Lord face to face. So, love you guys. This has been so fun, and I was dreading it. Even though the choir broke the cardinal rule, which is never make me cry. And I said that up front, and Mark said, it doesn't matter because you're not boss anymore. So, anyway, thank you for this. It's been lovely. And no matter where we find ourselves, you can always depend on me if you can find me.